Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the 9th PGS Lecture Series for 2022. This is brought to you by the Philippine Geographical Society in partnership with the UP Department of Geography. I am Darlene Gutierrez, and I will be your host for this event. Just a few reminders before we proceed. Kindly keep your microphones on mute during the presentation. We encourage you to interact by typing your comments and questions in the chat box, and they will be addressed during the open forum. This lecture is being simultaneously streamed in the UP Department of Geography YouTube channel. Also, please note that this meeting is being recorded and will be made available for viewing after the event. Okay. Before we proceed to the actual lecture, please welcome Mr. Eman Garcia, the President of the Philippine Geographical Society, to give the opening remarks.
Eman. Thank you, Ma'am Darl. Thank you, Ma'am Darl. Good afternoon, everyone. Today, we say never again, never forget. At the same time, I would like to welcome everyone to the 9th Philippine Geographical Society Lecture Series for the year. The PGS-LS is a monthly gathering where we feature a specific geographical undertaking in the Philippines. The PGS-LS is co-sponsored by the UP Department of Geography. This session of the PGS-LS will focus on weather forecasting. Our invited speaker will present his research on the simulated impacts of land cover change on Philippine seasonal climate, including his current involvement in operational weather forecasting at the Dost PAGASA. I am also happy to share the word cloud that we have generated from your registration. Keywords include prediction, interesting, challenging, estimate, vital, errors. Of course, there are words such as amazing, fascinating, forewarning, and my personal pick, turbulent. Turbulent, Robert. I am intrigued as to how these words can tie up to this afternoon's lecture. Muli, maraming salamat po for joining us. On behalf of the Philippine Geographical Society and the UP Department of Geography, welcome to the 9th PGS-LS for 2022.
Okay, thank you very much, Eman. Okay, our speaker for this afternoon is an alumnus of the Department of Geography, where he also served as the student department representative during his undergraduate program. He finished his MS in Meteorology from the College of Science in UP Diliman. Currently, he serves as weather specialist too in the Marine Meteorological Services section of the Weather Division of DOST PAGASA. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm welcome to Robert Badrina.
Thank you. Thank you, Ma'am Darl. Thank you, Kuya Eman. Sir Eman. Kuya ko yan dati when I was in my, ito mag-share screen na po ako. And thank you for inviting me. Actually, I was telling a while ago, thank you for heeding my request to invite me. Kasi I'm really looking forward to share. And I was telling last time that this is a coming home for me as a geography graduate 12 years ago. Grabe, more than a decade ago. So now I'm going to talk about something about that I'm doing. But at the same time, I was telling people that once a geography graduate or once a geographer, always a geographer. Feeling ko sa heart ko pa rin, I'm still a geography graduate. No? I mean, nandun talaga yung pagtingin sa in a spatial perspective. That's what I'm always telling. No? Kung ano man yung meron yung mga graduate ng geography, particularly from the University of the Philippines, laging nandun yung pagtingin spatially. So, ito po yung nabuo ko na na talk, no? And interestingly, when I was preparing this talk, I was reminded of, Ma'am Darl mentioned that I used to be the department representative, no? So, 12 years ago, nalabas nito yung mga nag-admit. 12 years ago, ma'am, at sa mga nakikinig, no? This was the Geography Week 2010, no? I was the Geography Department representative. So, hello sa lahat ng mga nandito na mga batchmates ko. I saw si Francis, mga batchmates ko. So, the title of the Geography Week was no boundaries. And interestingly, the topic for today is beyond boundaries. So mahilig talaga ako sa mga boundaries, no? So, but at the same time, always fascinated with how boundaries are being transcended. So, and basically, meteorology is like that, eh, na technically, meteorology, wala siyang boundary. It's beyond boundary because you're working on a fluid. You're working in a continuum, no? So, kaya very challenging. How do we understand the dynamics and how do we make forecasts, no? How do we develop forecasts or systematize forecasting sa meteorology? So, ito, I'm always fascinated with this. Lagi itong lumalabas. Lalala ko sa klase namin, minimension to na 80 to 90% of data sa geographic context. So, lahat ng mga information daw. So, I was curious. So, ni-research ko po, nagmula pala yung term na to kay William Robert, kapangalan ko pa, in 1987. So, meron yata isang conference. So, dun sinabi niya na 80% of data has a geographic context. So, 80% of data is geographic. So, that's why very important ang spatial context. And even sa field where I am right now in meteorology, very important yung spatial context because, again, the meteorological processes happens in space. And I think lahat naman ng bagay, lahat ng matter nangyayari sa space, no? So, yung inspiration po ng talk na to started, actually kaya ako nagka-idea na ito yung gusto ko maging talk. And at the same time, I would like to honor one of my early professors in meteorology who just died 2 months ago, Professor Josefina Arjete. Sa isang conversation namin, she was telling me na, I was telling her na, alam niyo po, nadi-discourage na ako kasi as a weather forecaster, alam mo naman kapag pumapalpak. Pero of course, hindi namin sasabihin yun. But may mga times na parang, hindi namin nakaka-capture. So, ito yung sinabi niya sa akin. Sabi niya, alam mo, dun, you will realize that meteorology and making forecasts is really very difficult. No? People think that this is very simple, but very dynamic. Particularly, and this is something that I would like to highlight, mas mahirap mag-forecast sa isang tropical climate or tropical area like the Philippines as compared to mid-latitude. Meron po tinatawag na barotropic and baroclinic atmosphere. Ibig sabihin yung magkaiba yung types and composition. Parang ganun mid-latitude and tropical region. That's something na kailangan din namin i-explain sa meteorology dito sa, for example, sa PAGASA, na bakit mahirap yung mag-forecast kasi very dynamic, lalo na sa tropical region. But ito yung po yung pinaka, kumbaga tumatak sa akin, sinabi. Ito po si Dr. Arjete, so she died in July this year. Sabi niya sa akin dito, hindi ka dapat ma-discourage and always remember the scales of motion. Kaya makikita niyo po, this talk is about scales. Kasi yun yung nag-inspire sa akin, sinabi ni Dr. Arjete. Sabi niya, always remember the scales of motion. Mahirap ipilit na interpolate. And sometimes I'm going to talk about interpolation in this talk. You're talking about a large-scale system and how it affects the small-scale or the local system. And it's very challenging. Di ba minsan ganun po, kahit sa social sciences, we have large-scale phenomena. Pero pagdating sa local scale, hindi siya nagmamatch. No? I encounter this term, autocorrelation, spatial autocorrelation. I'm not really expert on that field. But doon ko nakita how you relate different scale. Kaya ito yung naging idea or inspiration ng talk ko. So yun, I would like also to dedicate this talk to Dr. Josefina Arjete, is one of my first professors in meteorology, particularly in fluid dynamics. Pinasa niya ako, kaya ako natapos yung master. So salamat kay ma'am kung nasaan man siya ngayon. So again, what this talk is all about, in the next 20 to 30 minutes na, and thank you for all na umaten, lalo na sa mga kaibigan ko na pinilit kong umaten. Maraming salamat sa inyo. So, what this talk is all about, basically, I'm going to talk about the importance of scale in understanding the relationship of meteorological processes. Bibigyan ko lang kayo ng idea na the meteorological processes at different scale, yung sabihin, merong spatial, actually, supposedly, this should be spatial, but I realize, hindi lang nga pala spatial yung scale na tinitingnan sa meteorology, but also temporal. Kaya ginawa ko po siyang mas general na scales, no? So that's one. Second, challenges. Although I will not dig deeper, no, given our time, no. As much as possible, I want to cover a lot of topics. So the challenges on establishing a boundary on something that is in continuum. So parang ang idea is, paano mo nalagyan ng boundary yung isang bagay na continual? We're talking about atmosphere. So hindi mo naman pwede ikahon yung atmosphere, di ba? So paano natin ginagawa yun? So later, I'm going to show you. But at the same time, dun nyo makikita yung limitation. No? Because we're putting a boundary on something that is beyond boundaries. Kaya ngayon yung title nito. And then, saan nagmumula yung limitations ng meteorological forecasting? Bakit mahirap mag-weather forecast? To do forecasting the weather. Eh, kagaya ngayon, di ba? Meron tayong habagat season. So, saan nagmumula yung difficulty kahit na meron tayong advanced mga numerical weather prediction models, among others? So, I will just give you a glimpse of saan nagmumula at bakit it will take a while pa before, and sa tingin nga namin, talaga medyo matagal pa bago yung ma-perfect yung, or baka nga imposible pa yung ma-perfect yung weather forecasting in terms of using the numerical weather prediction. So let's just have some definition of terms, no? Eh kasi nung ginagawa ko po ito, I was reminded of my experience when I was second year in college. I was asked kung ano daw yung definition ng meteorology, and sabi ko study of meteors. Tapos natawa yung professor ko. Kasi mali yun, no? So meteorology is the science dealing with the atmosphere and phenomena including weather and climate. So weather is different from climate, and that's very important, no? Ang teacher ko, natatandaan ko ang teacher ko sa climatology, sa geography meron kaming climatology si Dr. Christian Sagin, no? So hindi ko pa siya nagiging teacher nung tinanong ako about meteorology, so and so weather is the state of the atmosphere. Again, ito lang yung difference ng weather and climate. Weather is the state of the atmosphere over a short period of time. Climate is the state of the atmosphere over a long period of time, or average weather. Madalas may term na hindi ko alam, maybe some of you already encountered the term. Weather is, climate is what we expect, but weather is what we get. Parang ganun. Or isa pang pagtingin doon, ang weather daw, ito daw yung kung ano yung susuotin mo. Ang climate naman, ito yung ano yung bibilhin mong damit. So yun ang ibig sabihin nun. Sa climate, ito yung average weather. And normally, when we talk about climate, we're talking about 30 years. No? 30 years of data. So kaya nga, every time na meron pong binabanggit na something an extreme event happened, sabi nila climate change agad. For us, especially in meteorology, it's difficult to claim that because you need to establish a certain pattern of more than 30 years. And then scale, no? Tinignan ko ho yung definition ng scale, so bumalik ako sa akin geography hat, no? So scale daw is the relationship between the real world size of a geographic feature and its representative on feature on a map. So ito po yung nakikita natin, 1:10,000, di ba, sa mga mapa. But isa pa sana na gusto kong, ano, which I'm not sure, maybe someone can correct me kung mali ako. But scale, I look at it as a grid size, parang gano'ng kalaki, especially sa spatial resolution, yung scale. So yun din yung isa kong pagtingin. Okay, so we're done with that. So ito, actually, yung buong talk, parang dito umiikot yun eh. Sa, here I'm showing you, and thank you to the COMET program. So, dito ipinapakita yung iba't ibang scale temporally. So, dito sa may y-axis natin, dito yung temporal. At sa x-axis, nandito yung spatial. And here, we're talking about different terms, no? So, meron tayong tinatawag na microscale, mesoscale. Sometimes, mesoscale is also called local scale. And ito ang very common, synoptic scale. Pag sinabing synoptic scale, so, yan ay, we're just dealing on different processes or different sizes ng system, like for example, front, squall, or tropical cyclone. So ano po yung size nila? So ito yon. Ano yung size, spatially, at gano'n siya tumatagal? So makikita ho natin dito, for example, yung turbulent, or tornado na lang, or thunderstorm, ito very common. Thunderstorm, yung scale niya umabot ng a kilometer, so makikita nyo dito. And then, pagdating sa temporal scale, tumatagal siya ng 1 to 2 hours. So yon. So ito yung, dito makikita yung iba't ibang scale, no? And then yung large scale phenomenon, for example, we have the MGO. MGO stands for Madden-Julian Oscillation, planetary waves, tropical cyclone, or even ENSO. ENSO, ito po yung La Niña and El Niño. So definition niya ay ang meaning niya is El Niño Southern Oscillation. So tumatagal yan ng around 7 to 8 years na cycle to. Even na climate variation. So yun lang, gusto ko lang po ma-imagine po ninyo yung iba't ibang scale temporally and spatially ng iba't ibang mga system. So ito yun. Tapos I remember when I was doing this, naalala ko, bumalik sa alala ko yung fluid dynamics namin when during my first year in masters. And sa mga geography students na nandito ngayon, ngayon pa lang sinasabi ko na sa inyo, kung magplano niyo mag-meteorology, ito yung unang haharapin talaga ninyo, the equations of motions. And I remember during our first day with Ma'am Josie Arjete, the late Josie Arjete, we talk about vector algebra. Ayun nga, I mean, I'm pretty sure sa mga geography majors or graduates na nandito ngayon, hanggang mat 100 lang tayo. So wala tayong vector algebra. Hanggang ngayon, iniisip ko paano ko nalampasan tong part na to ng aking ano, part po ng aking ano, na yun, isa to sa hinarap talaga namin na equations, no? Pero dito, hindi naman tayo magsasolve na equations. Pero gusto ko lang kasing ma-appreciate po ninyo na ito kasi yung pinaka na-appreciate ko na lesson namin sa fluid dynamics. We call it scale analysis. And scale analysis, the definition is, it's about estimating the magnitude of various terms in the governing equations for particular motion. So basically, tinatry lang i-represent ng mga equations sa iba't ibang mga systems. Yun lang naman yung gusto kong sabihin dito. And makikita nyo po dito, bawat system ay may kanya-kanyang scale, spatial scale, no? Ito, yung pinapakita ko, ito yung isa sa mga simplest equation, ito yung equation of motion, wherein the omega, that stands for angular velocity of the Earth, u is the three-dimensional velocity, while g is the gravity, and k is the unit vector directed upward. Tapos, ito po yung pressure gradient force. Yung pressure gradient force, ito yung changes ng pressure, no? At yung F, yun yung friction. So, bawat isa sa kanila, nag-represent ng certain force, no? It represents certain force and scale of force, no? At makikita din yun yung effect niya, either positive or negative, depende dun sa sign. And dito pa lang, sisimulan ko na, isa na tong sa mga limitations, no? Because there's a difficulty in representing even the smallest scale. Doon tayo nagkaka-problem. Kasi naiintindihan na natin yung friction, maybe yung pressure gradient force. Pero even the smallest scale, yun hindi pa natin fully naiintindihan. And yung mga governing equation natin ay hindi pa enough to capture all the systems na nangyayari. So isa to sa mga limitations ng scale, no? At limitations din ng meteorological forecasting. Okay, next. Okay, ito mabilis lang. Ano yung climate system? And this is very important. Bakit nag-iba-iba yung weather? Simple lang yung reason. Because of the exchange of energy lang naman yun, eh. You have an input, which is the solar radiation from the sun. So when it enters the atmosphere, since marami tayong iba't iba, we have the hydrosphere, atmosphere, biosphere, lithosphere. So yung interaction nun, doon nagkakos ng pag-iiba-iba ng weather, no? So you have a single input, even the solar input nga can differ, eh. But pagpasok niya sa Earth, because of the albedo, surface roughness, leaf area index, so yung exchange of energy, yun yung nagkakos kung bakit nagkakaroon ng iba't ibang mga weather system. Yun. So ang definition po ng climate system is the interaction between the different spheres. Yun lang naman yun. Which affects the weather, the climate. So it's all about absorption and exchange of energy. Now, ito, this is very interesting, especially those who are working with climate change. The past years, makikita ho nyo dito how it improved the global climate system. Ito, pag sinabi natin global climate system or global climate model, dito makikita kung paano nag-improve from dati, yung, ito po yung sinasabi ko sa inyo, grid scale or grid size or resolution. Dati, ang resolution natin nasa 500 kilometers. So yung mga system lang within 500 kilometers yung nakaka-capture natin. Pero as of now, noong assessment report 4, meron na bang 5? May 5th na, no? So hindi pa to updated. So may 5th na. Pero during that assessment report 4, ibig sabihin, yung 110 kilometer na mga processes, nakaka-capture na rin. So makikita po ninyo, noong mid-1980s, very simple lang, no? Rain, tapos carbon dioxide. Pero pagdating nung AR4, yung chemistry na, yung land surface, kasama, aerosol, nakikita din nyo how it improved through time na mas lumilit na lumilit yung mga system na nakaka-capture ng model. Ito lang gusto kong bigyang emphasis dito sa slide na to. As time goes by, the system that can be included or can be assumed in the model ay nag-increase din yung resolution. From dati, 500 kilometers ng mga system. Ngayon, kaya na natin 110. Ngayon, kaya na rin po. Ang isa sa mga natin is 3 kilometers. Mamaya makikita nyo po doon sa mga models na ginagamit namin sa PAGASA. As we have, yung pinakamataas natin resolution ay 3 kilometers, if I'm not mistaken. 3 kilometers. Okay, so yun lang. Again, sa loob kasi ng grid, this is very important, meron tayo yung vertical grid, pataas, saka horizontal, latitude, longitude. So yung mga process na nangyari within that grid, ayun yung kinukonsider ng mga global climate models. Of course, habang tumataas yung resolution, mas nakaka-capture natin even the small scale. Again, yun yung hina-highlight ko po sa talk na to, na habang nag-improve yung ating ano, yung ating forecasting capability, particularly using the numerical weather prediction models, ay nag-increase kasi yung mga scale na nakoconsider natin within the system. Okay, ito mabilis lang, the forecast process. Ito at least in PAGASA, this is what we do. So there are four steps. Basically, we gather data, we collect the data, we plot it in a weather map, then we make a forecast. It is very important, the first part, observation, no? So ito, very important, as what my former professor told us, without data, your guess is as good as mine. So I think sa lahat ng field to, very important, no? Even sa geography, in other fields, psychology, in physics, you need data in order to predict something. Ganoon naman yung research, di ba? The definition of research of a data to predict and to control. Parang ganoon yung idea niya. So sabi nito ni Dr. Liancio Amadori, if you don't have a data, your guess is as good as mine. Kaya makikita ho ninyo, actually malaking resources ang nilalaan ng PAGASA in gathering and other med centers in gathering data. Because if you have more data, you have more basis. Parang ganoon yun, you have more basis. So ito po yung pag-collect natin. So we have different means to collect data. We have satellite images, we have upper earth station, we have weather buoy, ocean data buoy, weather ship, among others. So sa buong mundo, meron tayong tawag na surface observations. Ang tawag ito, papasok na yung binanggit po kanina. Ang tawag natin dito is synoptic stations. So bakit siya synoptic stations? Ano ba ibig sabihin ng synoptic? Ang ibig sabihin ng synoptic lang, these are scale with around 100 to 1,000 kilometers. So, bawat point dyan, nagre-represent ng 100 to 1,000 kilometers. Yun yung idea. Around 100 yan. I think 1,000 yata. So, yun yung definition natin ng synoptic stations. No? So, sa Pilipinas, may papakita ko mamaya, meron tayong mga synoptic stations that collect data in a specific period of time. So, meron tayo, kinokollect natin yung surface. Nagko-collect din po tayo sa taas, no? Tawag ito yung mga radio zone. Yan. So, makikita ninyo yung difference. Sa synoptic station, we have 9,000 stations. Sa worldwide, there are 1,300 lang. No? Bakit kaunti lang? No? Of course, it's about resources. Just to give you an idea, around 25,000 pesos para magpalipad lang ng isang weather balloon ang nagagastos. So, imagine we're doing that twice a day. Tapos, and we're doing that 365 days a year. Dito sa Pilipinas, ayan, ganyan po yung itsura ng weather balloon. So meron tayong pinakamalapit dito ay sa Tanay. Ito po yung ating distribution ng mga stations. So makikita niyo ho rito, we have 9 upper air stations and we have around 59 synoptic stations. I think mag-increase pa to. So we have plans in PAGASA to increase the number of synoptic stations. So makikita ho ninyo, ito yung nagko-collect ng data meteorological data. So yon, ito another limitations, no, sa meteorological forecasting is the limitation of observation, because meron lang tayong six observation time, no? So nangyayari lang siya, so using the so every zero UTC, ang ibig sabihin ng zero UTC, di ba, universal time coordinate yata yan. So zero is 8 a.m. So, hindi lang sa Pilipinas, yung buong mundo, yung nakita nyong 9,000 stations sa buong mundo, nagko-collect sila ng mga meteorological variables 6 times a day. So, yung standard time is 0, and then 3 is 11, 2 p.m. Kaninang 5 p.m. may nag-collect ng data, tapos the next noon ay 8 p.m., tapos 11, and then 2 a.m. So, yung 59 stations or even the 9,000 stations around the world collect data at a specific time, sabay-sabay. Pagdating naman sa upper observation, ginagawa yan twice a day. So, every 8 a.m. and every 8 p.m. So, kinokollect ko yung data. So, ang tanong natin, so anong nangyayari noong 01 UTC or 02? So, wala. Hindi natin nakukapture yon. So, di ba, makita nyo dito pa lang, may limited na yung data na nakakapture natin. Nakukuha lang natin a specific point. So I want you to imagine, nagko-collect tayo, we're trying to understand the dynamic of the atmosphere, pero yung pag-collect natin ng data at a specific time, instantaneously lang. So dun pa lang, isa na to sa mga limitations sa meteorological forecasting, di ba? And at the same time, ito po yung sinasabi ko, no? Nakita ko lang to sa sa mga geography graduates or geography majors, you're familiar with the vector and raster format. So vector, Diba? Ito yung mga at a specific point, or line, or area feature. Yung raster format, ang tatanda ko lang, basta cell yun. Hindi natatandaan ko sa ano, sa raster, no? So, parang resolution siya. So, dito yung point to represent an area. Lagi kong, kahit dati tanong ko pa yun eh. For example, I collected the data here in Bataan kasi we have a station here in Bataan. Does it represent 10 kilometers na surface, ano, atmospheric condition din? Well, ang assumption natin, yes. But in reality, alam natin na hindi din. Diba? So that's another limitation, no? Yung point, and ito, scale din to eh. Scale problem din to. But again, these are the limitations ng mga assumptions na ginagawa natin. Okay. So now, I discuss about collection of data. Gusto ko i-share lang sa inyo how we do forecasting in PAGASA. So, ito, I'm showing you this one. Ang tawag namin dito, upper air analysis. Streamline analysis yung tawag ko dito. Wherein, ito yung mga data na collect sa mga upper air stations. Ito, what I'm showing you is at 850 millibar, meaning around 1 kilometer yata yan, or 1.5 kilometers. So, ibig sabihin, ito yung system. So, you have, for example, dito, nandito pa, buhay pa si Nan Madol dito eh, kailan ba to? September 15. So, ina-analyze namin, like, saan pupunta yung system, ayan. And then, we also have isobaric analysis. Pag sinabing isobar, iso means equal, bar is pressure. So, gumagawa kami ng mga pressure line para maintindihan namin yung mga movement. And this is very important. Makikita nyo ho dito, nagkakaroon na ng low pressure area sa Australia. Pag ito yung nangyari, nakikita namin pwede magpalit na yung magsisimula ng transition period. So, that's another, ano. Kaya very important tong mga weather maps. So, these are, ito, dito po yung, I'm going to give emphasis on this. This one is observed. So, these are observed data that we do manual analysis. So, mga forecaster yung nag-analyze nito. Nag-identify kami ng system at paano mag-move yung system. Itong next na data, these are the output of numerical weather prediction, NWP. So, we have, this one is from Europe, European model. This one is Korea. And then this one, if I'm not mistaken, I think WRF to. Yung WRF is the Weather Research and Forecasting. We have different resolutions. So this, ito, dinadownload na lang namin to. So, from other countries. But this one, niraran namin sa PAGASA mismo. So we have that 12 kilometer and we have the 3 kilometer resolution. So ito yung mga nagiging basis ng mga forecaster para malaman kung tingin ba nila, magtingin ba namin, magtutuloy-tuloy yung pag-ulan. Kagaya ngayon, no, we're expecting na slowly mag-improve na yung weather kasi yung southwest monsoon medyo hina na siya. Yun yung alam ko. Sorry, naka-off ako ngayon so hindi ko alam yung latest na update. So, and then this one is from Japan. So, ito yung lahat ng mga model. And aside from that, we also use, ito yung meteogram. Pag sinabi, yung, at this one, parang general view of the area to. But at the same time, ito naman point. So, ito yung meteogram for Science Garden. So, dito namin makikita across time, paano mag-change yung pressure, yung temperature, relative humidity, tsaka rainfall. Yung maganda pala, meron na rin kaming ginagamit ngayon na ensemble. Pag sinabing ensemble, collection siya of different weather models and then pwede naming makita yung probability. So, ibig sabihin, pwedeng percentage. Minsan kasi tinatanong ng mga tao, gaano kalaki yung chance na uulan? So, gamit to, pwede naming makita yon. Pwede kami magbigay ng percentage. Like 50% ang chance na uulan or magkakaroon ng medium, magkakaroon ng ganitong pag-ulan or 70%. Using ensemble or ansam ng mga models. So aside from that, and this one is very interesting also. So ito hindi na tong model. Ito naman ay, yan. Meron tayong tinatawag, ito, sorry, ipinasok ko lang to para lang maintindihan ninyo na, we also look at the regional scale. Oo. So itong Madden-Julian Oscillation or MJO, isa to sa mga tinitingnan namin in terms of kung ma-enhance ba or suppress yung convection. Normally, kapag yung MJO ay nandito sa bandang maritime continent, tayo po kasi nasa maritime continent, doon may magkaka-idea kami na sustained yung mga pag-ulan, particularly sa western side ng Luzon. Pero ngayon kasi, hindi, kaya mapapansin nyo yung ulan natin, hindi sustained, no? Mapapansin nyo yung ulan natin, after 2 hours, mag-stop. Kasi itong MJO, isa to sa mga nag-initiate ng continuous rain, wala siya ngayon sa maritime continent at nasa inactive phase siya. So dito pa lang, isa din ito sa sinasabi ko about challenges on relating large scale. Kasi large scale ito, tapos titingnan natin sa local scale. Minsan kasi may mga times na active yung Madden-Julian, pero may specific na lugar lang sa Pilipinas nagkakaroon ng pag-ulan. So again, meron kang large scale, then i-relate natin sa local scale. So yun. At doon ako very grateful sa geography kasi parang na-train yung utak ko to look at different scales. To look at how a large scale can affect a local scale. Even the El Nino and La Nina, no? Ngayon kasi nasa La Nina phase pa rin tayo. So how will it affect the weather in a particular locations in the country? Isa dito sa mga product ng weather for ng PAGASA ngayon, yung tropical cyclone threat potential. Actually, may nakikita kaming possibility of tropical cyclone development by next week. So, ito gamit din to, no? So, model din po ang ginagamit namin dito, ensemble siya ng iba't ibang mga models. Okay, I think sa nakalipas na na mga slides na discuss ko na what are the challenges in meteorological forecasting, number one. But in the past 5 decades or so, makita natin ang laki na in-improve ng weather forecasting sa mundo in general, no? Makita niyo every decade approximately 1 day improvement per decade. Pero again, saan pa rin magmumula yung mga challenges? Again, nakita nyo kanina yung frequency and the number of observations. Limited lang yung ating number of observations at yung temporal scale niya. Second, yung governing equations. Again, hindi natin nakakapture yung up to the molecule level, up to the atomic level. So ang pinakakaya lang natin around yung mga localized scale. And third one is computing power. So limited pa rin yung computing power. Although again, I'm going to give credit naman for the past 5 decades. Even ako, nakita ko how the computing model changed over for the past 10 years since I started doing meteorology in 2010. Ang laki talaga ng in-improve nung numerical weather prediction models natin. But again, ang dami kasing yung tinatawag na chaos theory, maraming mga components na hindi natin nakoconsider, nagbabago pa yung, hindi ko pa nga na-discuss dito yung aerosols, nagbabago yung composition ng atmosphere, consider din yon as a nagiging challenge, no? So again, ito, actually patapos na ako, so I just want to share with you my master's thesis, and it's very nostalgic because while I was doing my presentation, binasa ko ulit yung master's thesis ko. So syempre nakita ko, parang ganito pala ako mag-isip 8 years ago, no? So I finished in 2014, so ginawa ko to around 3 years ko siyang ginawa or 2 years ko siyang ginawa. So since geography graduate nga ako, so nasa puso ko ang geography, so hindi ko mayaalis yung gusto ko sana yung research ko, something about land cover and impact on climate. Yun yung gusto kong idea. So ito yung naging research ko. So influence ng land cover change on temperature, precipitation, at surface winds. And then inintindi ko, I tried to understand internal dynamics. Kasi paano nagbabago yung temperature, pressure, precipitation? It's all about absorption and exchange of energy. So ito yung tinry kong intindihin dun sa research ko. So I have this 100-year data. Actually, dalawa na lang siya. I got this from ESSC, Environmental Science for Social Change. So meron silang ganitong forest cover ng 1900 and 1999. So I use this as an input dun sa model. So I use the Regional Climate Model 3. Nasa 4 na yata siya ngayon, version 4 or 5, I forgot. So, and then, gumamit ako ng interpolation technique. Ano yung sabihin ng interpolation technique? So, from a vector, so this is a vector data, kinonvert ko siya into raster. Ayan, so meron kang pixel-based image by 15x15 kilometer. Actually, nung tinitignan ko itong research ko, nakakita ko ng parang, buti na lang at that time, hindi pa siguro masyadong sensitive yung mga tao. But actually, kung gagawin ko yung research ko ngayon, isa to sa i-question ko sa sarili ko, the interpolation technique that I use. Kasi ito, embedded, default lang dun sa GIS na ginamit ko at that time. But, ayan, merong pinublish ang PAGASA, and ano ko lang, si doctor na siya ngayon, geography graduate din natin, si Dr. Joseph Vasconcelio. Meron silang paper on ano yung best na spatial interpolation for climate monitoring. At sa actually, yun na rin yung ginagamit namin sa weather forecasting na yun pag nag-verify kami. So actually yun, again, di ba nabanggit ko po sa inyo yung representation of point to an area? So ito yun, ano yung mga interpolation technique na gagamitin? So if you're interested about interpolation, yan, you can look at this paper. Tapos doon nila in-explore kung ano yung best interpolation technique. In my case, hindi ko masyadong bigyan ng emphasis to, no? Kasi I think this alone is a study, no? Para kung interpolation technique lang, isang study na siya mismo, no? So dito, I just use the default sa software na ginamit ko. So yun. So from a pixel base, kinonvert ko siya into a raster format, and then from a raster, ginawa ko siyang ASCII format. Ito yung na-readable by the model. Ito yung pinasok ko dun sa model. So ganito yung idea niya. So you have a vector, then kinonvert ko into raster, then yung raster kinonvert ko into ASCII, at yun yung pinasok ko dun sa model. So, at gumamit po kami tinatawag na one-way nesting technique, meaning nag-run ako ng, dun sa research, nag-run ako ng isang 45-kilometer domain, and then yung output ng 45-kilometer domain, naging input siya sa 15-kilometer domain resolution. So again, meron po akong dalawang scenario, yung 1900 na using a 1900 land cover versus a 1999 or 2000 land cover. Tapos kinuha ko yung difference nila para makita ko kung ano yung naging impact. Assuming na you are, ito pa, yung assumption is using a 2007 na data. Parang ganun yung idea niya. So ganito yung simulations ko and climate model flow. So makikita nyo, I use the boreal summer and winter. No? Kasi yung boreal summer, pag sabing boreal, northern hemisphere. So I use the 1900 land cover, 1900 land cover using the JJA na simulation. JJA means June, July, August. DJF means December, January, February. Tapos ito yung mga dates. And then makikita nyo dito yung ICBC. Ito yung sinasabi kong challenge on the making a boundary on something that's a continuum. So pag sinabi, ang ibig sabihin ng ICBC, initial condition, boundary condition. Ang ibig sabihin po nito, this is the assumption, the process of absorption, exchange of energy in the climate system at a particular resolution. So, syempre, this is something I cannot explain no, kasi kahit ako hindi ko siya fully naiintindihan. Pero yung idea lang is, sa model, ipine-prepare mo yung boundary condition ng bawat resolution, if I'm not mistaken. Ano yung mga assumptions? So dito, isa rin to sa mga limitations ng study na na meron kang assumption lang sa isang specific na resolution. Ito yung results ko. So ayan, yung ganyan yung itsura ng mga result. Tapos ito yung conclusion from the study. So doon ko nakita, and this is very interesting because I presented this in one of the conferences. So doon ko nakita na dapat pala very contextual din yung pag-explain ko. Kasi dito lumabas na pag yung forest, ginawa mong crop, parang ganun. Tapos ang assumption pa yung crop natin ay water-fed, parang ganun. Or like palayan, so may mga tubig yun. Meron siya tinatawag na apparent cooling. Kaya sabi nung minsan pinresent ko to sa isang conference, sabi sa akin, so ibig sabihin ba, okay lang putulin yung mga puno parang ganun, at gawin natin cropland kasi dumalabig naman. But again, nung nagbasa pa ako ng mga ano, tsaka nagbasa pa ako po ng mga literatures and yung model mismo, apparent cooling lang siya. Pag nag-long term ano pa tayo, ang mangyayari, maglalabas din yung increasing temperature. So dito nakita namin dun sa research na yung crop to urban, nagkakaroon siya ng increase of temperature, increasing temperature na up to 0.4 degrees Celsius. No? Sa rainfall, medyo variable kasi. So nakita namin may rainfall increase. Yung forest, tsaka even yung ano, yung cropland to urban, basta generally increasing temperature din. So yun, so this is the end of my talk. So as a summary, ito lang po yung main takeaway ko for people who are listening today. So again, meteorological forecasting is highly dependent, tandaan nyo lang, highly dependent on the number and frequency of data. Again, kagaya po na sinabi ng aking former professor, without data, your guess is as good as mine. Second, again, isa sa mga challenges yung point data to represent specific spatial and temporal scale. So again, yon challenging din yon. Third, the current governing equations cannot fully capture the entire processes. Tama ba process ba? Yan, the process. So limited pa rin yung governing equations natin. Fourth, there's also limitation of the present computing power to consider even the smallest and the shortest possible scale. Yun, hindi natin nakaka-capture yung nangyayari sa atomic level. At isa yun sa mga nagiging limitations kung bakit hindi natin nakaka-capture mabuti yung buong system. Ano pa ba? And last, again, ito naman, and dito very specially, relationship between large-scale processes and how it affects the local scales continue to be a crucial component in understanding the meteorological processes. So ang gusto ko lang sabihin dito is that you have large-scale processes like MJO maybe and so, and how it translates or how it affects the local scale, let's say at a provincial level up to municipal level. Ayun. And I would like to show you this. No? Sana makita nyo. Kasi TikTok ano ako ngayon eh. I saw this in TikTok. Ayan. Ayan, nakita nyo. So, di ba? I think may mga experiences kayo na umuulan sa loob ng UP pero sa Pilcoa hindi umuulan. Di ba? So, doon, very, very variable. But at the same time, very interesting, very exciting yung field of meteorology because marami pa tayong bagay na hindi naunaw. Again, marami na tayong naintindihan pero mas marami pa tayong hindi naunawaan. And with that, I would like to thank you. Yan, thank you po sa lahat ng mga nakinig. And thank you again sa PGS at sa Department of Geography. This is like a coming home for me. This is my email, RB Badrina, my Facebook, and my Twitter. And again, since 21 ngayon, never again, never forget natin. Very important yon. I think that's also a data. Data na nangyari in the past na dapat hindi natin kinakalimutan. And with that, maraming salamat. And I would like to acknowledge lang, nandito ang aking one of my friends, si B.A. Racoma. So, he's a PhD candidate sa meteorology. I was telling him, pag hindi ko na kayang sagutin yung tanong, siya na yung sasagot for me. Thank you at maraming salamat po.
Okay, thank you very much, Robert, for that very interesting presentation. And at this point, we'll be proceeding with the open forum. I would like to encourage everyone to type in their questions in the Zoom chat box so that we can address them. Or you may raise your hand and wait to be acknowledged before you can directly ask your question to Robert. Okay, so there are some comments here in the chat. No, and I just like to acknowledge this from Kevin Christopher. Ang sabi niya, weather is your mood, no? But climate is your personality from Bagtasa, no?
Yes, yeah. He's also a professor in meteorology, Dr. Bagtasa.
Yeah, okay. And then from Celeste, no? In spatial statistics and GIS, the issue that affects scale in analysis is called the modifiable aerial unit problem.
Thank you, Celeste. That's a nice input. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so who would like to ask a question? Mm-hmm. I think Robert is ready to answer your questions now. Anyone? Okay, so kung wala, pwede ba ako, Robert?
Okay, opo, ma'am. Sana masagot ko. Sige po.
Of course. I just want to ask, meron bang relationship ang ENSO with MJO? Can they occur at the same time? Kasi di ba may season din yan, di ba?
Tama. Ma'am, that's very interesting, no? It's a very interesting. First, isimulan ko muna po. ENSO is a 7 to 8 years na cycle yon, no? And ang ibig sabihin nun, at tanda-tanda ako, ang definition ng ENSO, that's a temperature difference, feathering pressure difference between Tahiti and Darwin. So that's one. Tapos again, yung MJO naman, around 80 days, hindi ako nagkakamali, 80 to 90 days naman na na process. I think, ma'am, una, number one, to be honest, wala pa po akong nabasa about the relationship. Pero I think the ENSO can, ayan, sabi ni Kevin dito, inter-annual, correct. Inter-annual, ibig sabihin 9 years. And then yung MJO intra-seasonal, normally mga 3 months, within 3 months, nagbabago. At least logically, iniisip ko, possible po na maapektuhan ng ENSO yung intensity na MJO. I think yun pwede mangyari. At least in theory. Pero wala pa po akong nabasa about it. But they make sense kasi they work or I mean, this happen in the same spatial, ma'am. Doon po sa around Pacific Ocean, Pacific. From Indian to Pacific. So since they happen, both of them happen, pero magkaiba lang po sila ng tempo. Again, ito nga yung sinasabi ko, yung temporal resolution nila, magkaiba lang kasi yung sa 8 years, yung sa naman, 90 days yata, if I'm not mistaken. So I think na may relationship sila. Pero kung ano yung specific, medyo challenging po natin masabi yun.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. No, actually, talagang it is really very challenging to look at these scales. Eh. And there's another one, pero sa may Atlantic naman, di ba? Yung North Atlantic Oscillation. Opo.
Yes.
Yeah, that's another one. Yeah.
Meron pa po isa, ma'am, yung sa may Sahara Desert, yun din. Oo, merong ano din doon.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so from again from Kevin, no, time scale wise they are different but can coincide on occasion. Thank you. And from BA Racoma, very active area of research ang relationship ng ENSO and MJO. May mga studies or cases po ng ENSO natitrigger ng westerly wind bursts caused by MGO. Okay, so that's interesting, no? Siguro, yeah, this is another area of research na siguro kung sino ang may interest, no, to pursue this. Yeah. Thank you. And anyone from our audience?
Ma'am, parang may comment po dito about ano daw yung interested sa meteorology pero hindi siya magaling sa math. So, encouragement or advice daw, Ma'am Darlene. Siguro masasabi ko lang, ako mahina rin ako sa math na nag-drop ako ng math 11. But I think mahirap siya pero kaya. Mahirap siya pero kaya.
And I think you are an example, no?
Yes, oo, totoo, totoo. Na success story ako. Mahina talaga ako sa math, I mean. Pero yon, I think yung kailangan lang kasi doon ko po natutunan na ang math, kasi ang sikreto naman sa math is practice. Natuto naman ako.
Yeah, that's right. Kaya nga hindi rin pwedeng alisin ang math sa geography curriculum.
Yes, oo.
Okay, so meron tayo dito from John Paul. Good day po. Is the discontiguous nature of the Philippines also a challenge in weather forecasting for PAGASA?
Yes, definitely. Maganda yung point mo. Actually, yung ano natin, yung pagiging archipelagic natin, napakahirap niya. Tapos imagine yung Pilipinas, may Pilipinas dito, you have dun sa eastern side, nandun yung Pacific Ocean, sa western side, meron kang China, Indochina area. So just imagine the interaction between the land. Di ba yung familiar tayo sa land, breeze, sea breeze? So yun, nasa gitna tayo ng isang malaking ocean at nasa gitna at sa other side naman meron tayong land. So imagine the interaction between that plus archipelagic tayo. So doon natin makikita how the variation ng weather natin could be very challenging. Ayan.
Yeah. And also the physiography of the Philippines.
Yes, ma'am. Opo.
Yeah. Now, my comment, my share dito si Kevin na merong 2007 study about ENSO and MJO relationship.
I think this is very latest po.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, so mahina rin daw sa math si B.A. Racoma.
Oh, pero PhD na, pero physics graduate po yan.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, another question from Kyle Axel. Are there any new technological advancements na although hindi pa ginagamit, pinag-aaralan po right now? Meron ba?
Siguro meron, baka hindi ko lang alam, ma'am. Ganun yung sagot ko na. I'm not sure. But I'm sure meron po. Actually, ngayon po, we're isa po sa mga research field na pinupuntahan natin ngayon. More yung ano na, impact-based forecasting. Isa yan sa mga tinitingnan din namin. Ano na yung impact ng weather. But in terms of improving the numerical weather prediction model, I think because of increasing computing power, kaya na-increase na po namin yung resolution ng ano ng mga studies natin. Kagaya ng paulit-ulit kong binabanggit kanina, kung dati around 500 kilometers yung naaral natin, ngayon kaya na po natin mag-aral ng mga as size as 3 kilometers. Yun yung maganda.
Yeah. That's a great improvement actually, no? Okay, so Kevin here has shared, no? The article. And then siguro kung sino man sa inyo ang gusto rin na mag-i-download nilang ito, just click on the link.
Thank you, yeah. Kevin. No?
Thank you.
Meteorology graduate po natin siya.
Okay.
May isa po pong question.
All right. So from Kyle, machine learning and AI po. Okay, so there's a question here from Juan Carlos. As an established weather specialist of DOST PAGASA, do you still do manual math for the forecast and data analysis? Or is it all done via software na po?
Yun. Ano na siya? Awa ng salamat sa Diyos. Ano na siya? Computer na siya. Sa computer na siya. Kasi marami pa kami bang ginagawa. So tinipid na siya ng computer. But alam nyo, what I realized, there was a time na nag-discuss kami ng equations kasi inaaral namin yung pagpasok ng bagyo. So titingnan namin yung friction, ganyan. But parang in my 3+ or 4 years or so in PAGASA, parang once lang namin ginawa yun. So ano na po, ma'am? Lahat po nasa computer na po. Computer na nagko-compute.
Okay. At least mas madali at mas mabilis.
Yes. So,
yeah. Okay, so may tanong si Doms. Ano ang challenge sa pagtayo ng more stations sa Philippines? May kinalaman po ba ito sa available equipment? Or mas may kinalaman pa ito sa topography or may iba pang reasons? Salamat po.
Yeah. I think, ma'am, ang makakasagot po dito more yung engineering department namin. But I think, logically speaking, I think it's the resources. Kasi hindi madaling mag-acquire ng lupa. Then you need people, personnel, you need equipment, you need to maintain it. So I think it's more on the resources. So the limitations in terms of observation, both in the surface and the upper air, is basically it's because we have finite resources. Like what I've said, malaki pong resources yung nilalagay po natin sa pag-collect ng data.
Yes. Thank you. Robert, meron ditong gustong magtanong, no? Tungkol sa ano po yung steps na dinaanan sa pagpasok sa Masters ng Meteorology. So meron tayong isang geography major na interested. Nasa DOST PAGASA na po ba ikaw, sir, while doing your Masters?
In my case, actually, nandito din yung aking sabay ko na pumasok, si Jod. Hi, Jod. No? So nag-start kami ni Jod na doon kami sa ano, sa... nag-apply po kami ng scholarship. Una sa PAGASA, but at that time, wala ng scholarship sa PAGASA. So, through DOST na po kami. And then, so yun, ASTHRDP yung pangalan ng program. At ngayon, interestingly, 25,000 na siya yung stipend. So, talagang enough to serve, for you to be sustained. So, yun po yung pinaso ko. And I utilize that, I avail that scholarship. Tapos, after nun, naging involved ako sa isang research. Actually, gusto ko rin sana isama sa to, pero masyadong manang malayo. But I was part of the another research. Very interesting po na research, ma'am Darl, because it's about biogeography. So naging research assistant po ako ni Dr. Vallejo ng IESM. Doon ko mas natutunan ano naman yung impact ng climate change on shells. Very interesting study rin talaga. And then after that, naging part po ako ng NOAA-WISE. It's another research project. So for a while, naging RA ako sa UP. And then, inabsorb po ako ng PAGASA. So, very grateful ako na tinanggap po ako ng PAGASA. So, ganun yung flow. So, through a scholarship. But I'm not really sure now with IESM. Kasi during our time, yung time namin ni Jod, hindi po nire-require na magkumuha ng mga physics units. Kasi sabi ko nga po sa inyo, very highly sa physics, yung physics and math, yung meteorology. So, but I'm not sure. Maybe someone can, kung may rule na yata ang IESM ngayon na kailangan kumuha ng mga units. So, parang ganun.
Yeah. Okay. So, we still have several questions here.
Oo nga. Pero,
before I acknowledge Kevin, no, who I think wants to speak, meron dito, I have a question. Are there any research machines or software done in order to supplement those who are colorblind or other similar disadvantages but would like to work in the field? Yeah.
Ma'am, none that I know, ma'am. Baka mayroon, pero hindi ko lang po alam.
Sorry. Pa.
I think that's interesting.
Okay. Okay, so maybe I'd like to acknowledge Kevin before I call BA.
Hi, hello. Good afternoon. Just to answer yung kung may math requirement ba sa IESM.
Ano na ba ngayon, Kevin?
When I entered ISM noong 2017, we were told na required na kami na at least up to math 22.
Ano na yung math 22 ngayon? Anong katumbas niya nung
panahon? Yun yung 54-55. So yun yung sinasabi mo, Sir Robert, na yung hindi mo naabutan yung differential equations. Yes, nandun na siya covered. So re-require na siya. At saka at least hanggang physics 73.
Okay. O yun.
Yun na yung re-require. By the way, when I applied noon. Kung wala ka pang ganun na units, you will be told to take those back subjects.
Ayun.
So that was in effect since 2017 po.
Thank you. So yun, sa mga interested mag-meteorology, as early as now, no, kung gusto niyo talaga, those are the requirements.
Okay. Thank you, Kevin. And then may dagdag dito si BA Racoma. No? If interested po mag-MS in meteorology, you can check the IESM website. No? Looking forward daw to working with you kung sakali pong gusto nilang mag-apply. So, meron ditong link na I think you can just click. I-click nyo na lang yung link dito. No? And bago ko i-acknowledge si BA Racoma, no? Celeste has a question, Kuya Robert. Napapansin po natin na in recent years ay lumalakas ang mga dumadaan na bagyo sa Pilipinas at medyo nagbago na rin po ang mga typhoon track. Napapansin natin na yung Mindanao na hindi gaano nadadaanan ng bagyo noon ay nakakaranas na ng mas maraming bagyo ngayon. Ang tanong ko po, what lies ahead for the Philippines in terms of climate and meteorological events? May napansin po ba kayong significant changes over the years?
Yeah. Ma'am Dar, thank you po. And Celeste, Ma'am Celeste, thank you for that question. Actually, that's very interesting. No? Siguro in the future, we can invite si Dr. Vasconcelos. Yan kasi yung research niya sa Korea. Yan yung kayan po yung doctorate, doctoral dissertation. Yan yung po yung dissertation niya. At isa sa mga nakita niya doon, yung Northwest Pacific High, yun yung high dun sa may bandang sa may Siberia, lumalaki po yata siya, kung di ako nagkakamali. Parang lumalakas siya. At yun yung nagkukos kung bakit dumadami yung tinatawag natin na binigyan siya ng term na Christmas typhoon kasi nangyayari nga siya during December. So, yun po yung isa sa mga observation nakita. So, ngayon po yung nagiging pattern based sa research na yun, hindi po dumadami yung bagyo pero lumalakas siya. So, most probably baka nga po related yun dun sa increasing. Kasi definitely meron naman po talaga tayong increasing temperature eh. So, mas lumalakas po yung dami ng mga bagyo. Tapos, mas nagiging southward siya. Kaya, talagang untrend na for the Philippines, particularly in Mindanao na hindi sanay sa bagyo, mukhang mas kailangan ng maging improve, no? Improve po yung ano, yung adaptability ng ano sa Mindanao. So yeah, may research po na yon if you're interested na sa internet naman. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you Robert, no? Ito merong shinare si Dexter Nino. Just to share, Ariel Rojas, the current resident meteorologist of ABS-CBN TV Patrol, he was an intern while studying his master's in meteorology here in UPD. So, nasa PAGASA na siya habang nag-aaral ng MS in meteorology. Okay. Meron pa dito isang tanong bago BA, saglit lang ha. Pwede ko po bang tanungin, kumusta po ang wage or sweldo of a meteorologist? And ano pong mga job opportunity ng someone na graduate of meteorology?
Ano po ako, salary grade 15. Ano ba yung salary grade 15? Assistant, ay ano na po bang katumbas? Instructor 4 yata yun sa UP, if I'm not mistaken. Salary grade 15 yung entry level. Tapos, ano pa yung ibang jobs? I think some of us na nakatapos, kasi meteorology is highly data science eh. So yung iba nag-geared towards data science. May makilala ako na doon pumasok.
Okay.
Kumakalaga pong skill yon actually sa lalo na sa research.
Sige, bago ko makalimutan, I'd like to acknowledge BA Racoma. Would you like to speak or comment?
Sige po, magandang hapon po. Okay. Thank you po for acknowledging. Hi Robert, thank you rin for inviting. Ako po si BA. Faculty po ako sa ISM and napag-usapan din lang po namin sa recent meetings namin yung admission sa sa ISM. So sorry po kung nang papirate kami ni Robert ng students. Pero in terms of the math requirement, if una i-check po namin yung CWAG nila sa math and science. And if hindi po siya sufficient, meron naman po kami mga audit courses and mga week-long training sessions just to get you up to ano. So we're trying to improve yung intake namin para matulungan din po yung mga estudyante. Para kung gusto niyo po maging katulad ni Sir Robert. Ayan po. Salamat
or
po.
Para hindi rin kayo mahirapan. Kaya ako noon. No.
Okay, so thank you. From Juan Carlos, meron ditong question. When it comes to upper air or synoptic stations regarding better accuracy of forecasting, would it be better if we had more stations or better stations? Like TechWise.
Thank you, Ma'am Daryl, and thank you for that. Oh, of course. Again, the more data you have, the more chances of winning. Eh. Parang the more, mas naiintindihan mo yung process. Yeah. Yes, yes.
Right. Yeah. Okay, another one is weather more difficult to predict in city areas? For example, due to urban heat island effect than rural areas, are there more variables than that make weather prediction different in each area?
Yes, ma'am, definitely. When I was doing my master's thesis, may nakita akong isang research impact ng urbanization on thunderstorms sa Sahel to somewhere in Africa. Pero hindi ko masyadong binigyan ng importance. I mean, hindi kasi siya masyado ano. Pero opo, mas makikita niyo talaga yung pagkaiba ng parang city climate, city microclimate. May tatawag tayong ganun eh, parang microclimate.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Now, here's one from Kevin uli, no? Thesis topic daw niya yung pag-chase ng typhoon tracks. So, would you like to give more information Tito Kevin, just a short one lang.
Yeah, short one lang po. Actually, similar yung results ng thesis ko sa results ni Sir Vasconcelio, and I was able to validate and confirm that it's actually a manifestation of climate change, yung paglobo ng West Pacific subtropical high, especially during the later months of the year. And that climate shift, which I also observed in my thesis, happened during the time starting 2010, 2011, so the recent decade. And this is caused actually by changes sa ENSO and sea surface temperature differences between the East Indian Ocean and the Western Pacific. Kumbaga, mas mainit kasi yung Indian Ocean, yung heat difference causes yung water circulation to change. So yung pagdescend ng water circulation dun sa Western Pacific, nagpapalakas ng subtropical high, kaya lumobo siya. And may mga ano nga din na dun rin sa paper ni Sir Tasha na posibleng maging new normal siya. So expect na Visayas and Mindanao will have to become more adaptive to increase their coping capacity for more typhoons to hit them during the later parts of the year po.
Ah, okay, yeah. Thank you. And may I add to that? No. Meron lang akong iniisip na kasi 'di ba when you say lumolobo yung subtropical high, does it mean that it pushes the pressure belt southwards? So yung trucks would also be pushed southwards. Ibig sabihin, yung Mindanao na dati ay hindi gaanong naapektuhan except of course the northeastern part, no, of the island, ay magkakaroon na rin in the central part of Mindanao, no, unless talaga na magpi-prevail pa rin doon ang intertropical convergence zone, di ba? So yun lang yung isa ding naiisip ko na yung paglobo ng subtropical high might push, di ba, push southwards.
Yes, I don't know. Yes, actually that's what's actually happening po, kasi mechanism po ng mga low pressure systems ay iwasan yung high. Kasi nga parang air gyres sila, parang gears. Kasi in opposite directions po yung circulation nila.
Steer din siya.
Yeah, lalo na at the 500 millibar level. So dun yung steering height ng mga bagyo. So since yung contours ng subtropical high po ay measured along 850 MB saka 500 MB. So sa 500 MB, kung lumolobo siya, it serves as like a wall.
Yeah,
an air wall preventing the tropical cyclones from recurving. Yun po.
Okay, yeah. So maybe we can just have one last question here.
Okay, sige
from,
po.
BA Rahoma, how would you imagine na magagamit natin and ng PAGASA ang data influx from remote sensing sources na posibleng makuha natin through the efforts of the Philippine Space Agency?
Okay, sige po. Thank you, Ma'am Darl. Thank you, Sir BA, for that question. Actually, just to give you an idea, meron po tayong subscription ngayon sa Himawari. Himawari is the satellite po ng Japan. Every 10 minutes nakakakuha tayo ng data doon. So, kumbaga, nagsasubscribe tayo doon. And I think, again, kagaya ng ulit-ulit ko sinasabi, the more data you have, the more chances of winning. So, pag mas marami tayong data, at eto nga, if we have this from Philippine Space Agency, mas may kakayahan po tayo na i-direct kung saan lugar natin gusto kumuha ng data. Yun naman yung maganda. So, I think, Sir BA, the data that will come from the Philippine Space Agency would be very helpful for us in terms of getting more information, particularly in tropical cyclones. So, and just to I had this meeting with people working in Space Agency nga po. Ng Japan, kasi partner po natin yung Japan din. So pinakita nila sa amin yung picture na nakuha ng mga, I'm not sure if that's Maya, that's one of our cube satellite natin or micro satellite natin. So doon pinakita, kaya natin i-navigate ngayon yung micro satellite natin para makuha natin yung gusto nating mga images. Yun naman yung maganda. Mas mapapersonalize natin na sense po.
Okay, so John Abel is raising his hand. Yes, can you just unmute and maybe ask your question?
Hello po, good afternoon. Yes. Good evening. Hello po. Hello po sa inyo lahat. Good evening po. We have a question kay Sir Obet. Sir Obet, hello po. Ayan. So ang question kay Sir Obet, syempre, nakasama ko na rin si Sir Obet kasi nung on-the-job training ako sa forecasting. So, my question is, how do you feel kay Sir Obet regarding sa mga ano? Halimbawa po, pagka may mga nagkasabing tao na mali ang forecast, o kaya may mga fake news na lumalabas, how do you feel po kaya pag forecaster po ng PAGASA na nakikita niyo po yung ganun? Lahat-lahat, yung effort, push na, tapos yung nakikita pa rin ng tao, ganito, mali yung forecast, ang isa rin sa nakikita natin ngayon, yung mga fake news lumalabas. Yun po. Thank you.
Salamat Jan. At si Jan po ay taga City Disaster Office ng Makati, and just recognize ko lang din, we have a geography graduate na division chief nila doon, si Sir Ryan Tagle. Mas matanda siya sa akin sa geography. Hi Sir Ryan. Anyway, so thank you for that question. Madalas biruan namin sa PAGASA, I was always telling my co-forecaster, ano ka ba pag may mga nang babash sa amin? Kasama yan sa binabayaran sa atin para may sisihin, parang ganun. Kasi parang, di ba, I think it's a human nature na may biniblame. So that's one, parang sanay naman na, that's one. Second, when people ask questions, kasi I think during this time, no, mas marami na pong mga sources of information sa Facebook, minsan kinocompare pa kami sa Japan, sa JTWC, sa iba pang mga weather agencies. Ganito lang yung sagot ko madalas dyan, na parang we are more accountable than them. Ayun lang. So when we make a forecast, we make sure that we are accountable with what we're saying. And since we have the accountability and we have the responsibility, so kaya namin panindigan ko na yung sinasabi namin. And kaya rin po, very excited ako i-present itong presentation na to, because I want people to understand that forecast is challenging. And I want to show you where it's coming from. And malaki na in-improve natin, but there's more work to do. Yun naman po yun. So ako personally, parang sanay na rin po ako doon, as much as I know that I did my job. And I think, wala rin namang perfect science eh. I think wala namang, parang lahat naman may uncertainty. Kaya nga po pag tinatanong kami madalas, we always tell them about the uncertainty. Kasi actually meteorology is a science of uncertainty like any other field, I think. So yun, ganun namin siya, ganun yung approach namin sa kanya, Jan. So pag tinatanong kami, bakit si ganitong weather page, ganito yung sinabi, bakit? We always tell them na, there was a time ma'am, kasi nag-YouTube din kami, nagpe-present kami. At ang dami may nag-comment doon na parang, tingin ko ganito yung mangyayari, bakit sinasabi mo na mahina yung habagat halimbawa. And turn out, tama ako. Ano ka ngayon? Parang ganun na. But again, what I was saying is, hindi lang kasi yun yung tinitingnan namin, we are also looking at other data. Ngayon, kung nagkakamali ba sa tingin ng mga tao, that's part of the uncertainty. Yun naman yun. Salamat po.
Okay, thank you Robert.
Thank you po.
And alam kong marami pa tayong gustong itanong, no, kay Robert. Siguro pwede nyo na lang siyang i-email,
yes,
for your other questions, so, para ma-address niya sa inyo directly. No? And we all know that it is very difficult to deal with a very dynamic, no, matter such as the atmosphere. No? So again, thank you very much, Robert, for your
enlightening, you po. Salamat sa pag-invite,
and exciting lecture. So at this point, allow me to present the certificate of appreciation for our guest speaker, okay? And let me read the certificate for Robert. The certificate of appreciation is given to Robert Badrina for the valuable insights and expertise shared as virtual resource speaker for the talk, Beyond Boundaries, Challenges of Relationships Among Various Meteorological Scales, as part of the Philippine Geographical Society Lecture Series 2022, held on September 21st, 2022, and signed by our department chair, Dr. Joseph Palis, and the president of the Philippine Geographical Society, Emmanuel Garcia. Robert, so thank you very much again for
the
enlightening lecture. Okay, so to provide a short summary of the lecture and give the closing remarks, please welcome Dr. Joseph Palis, Chair of the Department of Geography.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gutierrez, and thank you very much, Robert, for your talk. I don't think summary is an appropriate word to what I'm going to say. But let me just say at least that although I have taken climatology when I was an undergrad, it was not the area that I wanted to focus on for my graduate studies. However, I did learn a lot from Robert's presentation, and even more so from the discussion that ensued in the Zoom chat, as well as the sharing that came with it. No. But one thing, one major takeaway that we can get from the talk, of course, is the uncertainty, like Robert has mentioned, in weather prediction. Most of the time, there's a kind of self-importance that comes with people who would say that ano ba yung pag-asa, ano, hindi naman nila kayang, or ano kaya mga weather forecasting, hindi naman nila kayang magbigay ng accuracy, no? So as though it, as though there is a very precise and an exactitude that can be predicted a mile off from meteorologists, you know. So there is, as Robert has mentioned, there is a complexity, there is a lot of processes that are being considered in order to come up with weather forecast. And I think one thing we need to also remember is that it minutely change, not just hours, but even minutes. So that's one thing that I think, for people like Robert, who has an online presence when it comes to weather forecasting, to remind people to be vigilant and to be also proponents of citizen science, to read things on their own and engage with weather forecasting, because it's not just the province of those people who studied meteorology and climatology. So thank you very much, Robert, for this. We hope to have more interaction with this, especially also in issues, and I'm sure you're more than competent to talk about this, but also maybe in the future we can talk about the climate crisis and it, the more supranational dimensions of weather and climate. So thank you very much, Robert, and welcome back to the department. Yes. At this point, let me just say that September 29, we have a speaker who's coming up for the geography webinar series. This is pretty much like the PGS lecture series, except that it's a little bit more academic. But then again, Robert's talk was also very academic, but with very applicable insights. Peter C. from the UP Department of Philosophy is going to talk about ethics and governance, but he wanted to somehow make it a little bit more geography friendly. So he calls this Geo AI, right? Artificial intelligence. Actually, the title is only Geo AI and governance, right? But he's going to talk about ethics as well. So September 29, that's a Thursday at 5 p.m. Please come to that talk. You know, there's going to be, just like Robert's talk, there's going to be a lot of intersection with what we do in geography. You know, and of course, in October, we have two more speakers are coming. One of them is an alumnus of our department. The other is a professor from UP Visayas. November and December as well, we have guests. And of course, the International Conference on Geographical Studies, which I'm going to talk a little bit more in a moment. At this point, let me just say that to become members, you can go to our website, psgeographicalsociety.com. Although right now it answers, when you type that, it comes out psgeographicalsociety.wordpress.com. .org. And you can see some of the requirements, basic requirements for to be members. It's a wonderful time to be part of this. Whether you are training geography and geography enthusiasts, we need more allies and colleagues. And if you want to look at our lecture, just similar to the one that was given today, you can go to YouTube and type UP Diliman Department of Geography, and we'll show you all the talks that we've had. We've had several talks as exciting as the one that Robert has given us, including film geography by Jessica Jacobs from Queen Mary University of London. Also, we have something on Japan as an imagined place, and many others, right? So it straddles a lot of issues in geography. It's very exciting, actually, to look to listen to some of these talks. Excuse me. And the International Conference on Geographical Sciences is coming up in November, and the blurb will come out tonight or tomorrow. And as you can see from I was about to give a suspenseful question to many of you, but anyway, here goes. The theme for this year is emotional geographies, and of course, emotion and affect, just like weather and climate, can also be seen from geographic lenses. It's not just emotional response, but also the way places are made and made, produced, created, imagined, and thought of. So there's a lot of intersections. And I actually wonder if there is a study done in the Philippines that connect weather and climate with emotional responses. I'm sure there is, but right now it's a blank. So it's something that some of you might be interested to send. Our deadline is October 15, and all you have to do is submit an abstract, and then we just have to review it and then send you a quick note if that gets accepted or not. Emotional geographies, but it doesn't necessarily have to really intersect that, but we would like it if it's a little bit more emotional geography adjacent, right? So be on the lookout for that. It's going to be an exciting time. And